Well, hi, everybody. This is Paul Fisher from the University of Florida, IFAS Extension, and it's a real pleasure to be speaking with my good friend Dan Jacques from Sungrow Horticulture today. I've known Dan for more than two decades from the time that I was at University of New Hampshire and now at University of Florida. And Dan's got a tremendous amount of expertise in the growing media area, and I think there's a lot of excitement and interest about organic production. Over to you, Dan. I'm really looking forward to learning about vermicompost and earthworm castings.
Okay, thanks, Paul. Well, welcome everybody, and I thank you for the opportunity to talk a little bit about this. This is something that is near and dear to my heart. It's really something where I've really seen some major differences when earthworm castings are used. So without further ado, let's go on. I'm just going to talk about using earthworms in organic production. I just think that they are a major part of successful organic production. Just to start off, definition of what worm castings are, or vermicompost. It's a stable end product of decomposition of organic materials by earthworms and microorganisms. One of the great values of it is it's something that's nutrient rich and biologically active. And worms will consume almost any type of organic material. So the type of feedstock influences the nutrient content, which can vary widely. I remember visiting a production facility for vermicompost, and the researcher there said that probably one of the best feedstocks would be litter from hog production, but the smell is just way too strong to deal with, so it's not something that they would normally use. But depending on exactly what the feedstock is, nutrient levels can vary quite a bit. But within a type of feedstock, they seem to be pretty stable. One of the things with earthworm castings is that it is a relatively expensive component. Usually in a mix, we'll put it in at 5 to 10%. Some research at Cornell showed that even 20 to 25% was beneficial, but you have to start weighing the cost benefit. You have to really do a cost benefit analysis. And we feel that 5 to 10% seems to be a pretty good range of for the earthworm casting use. So when we're talking about organic production, one of the biggest problems organic crop producers run into is fertilizing. It's not as easy as grabbing a bag of water-soluble fertilizer, putting it in a stock tank, and running it through an injector. It's much more difficult to fertilize, and there's really a limited number of fertilizers that can be used in fertigation, and they're generally pretty low analysis. Some of the more common soluble, and I put that in quotes, in some cases they're not really fully soluble. Fertilizers could include fish emulsions, seaweed-based fertilizers, seed extracts. Another one that is very soluble is mined products, something like sodium nitrate. Sodium nitrate can be used in organic production under certain conditions. It's not one that is used extensively, but can be used when a high amount of nitrogen needs to be added quickly to a crop. The negative part you run into there is you're dealing with sodium, adding sodium to the crop as well. Usually starter charges that are in organic fertilizers cannot fully feed the entire crop. So at some point, a grower needs to start adding fertilizer, whether they top dress with something that'll break down slowly or use some of these liquid fertilizers, that's up to them. When you use a compost, you can reduce the need for additional feed. And we've done trials in the past where we show that you can grow even a tomato plant to the point of being transplantable to outdoor gardens or to a field with worm castings and starter charge and not applying any additional fertilizers. But there we're only looking at a 4-6 week crop. Once you get beyond that, you definitely need to start adding more fertilizer. So how can worm castings help with fertilization? Earthworm castings increase the overall level of available nutrients in the mix. We generally see a pretty good dose of nitrogen available to the plants and some potassium and some of the micronutrients. There's a high level of biological activity, which I feel may lead to faster breakdown of the added organic fertilizers. So if we're adding dry fertilizer charge to the mix, organic fertilizer charge, it may break down more readily with higher biological activity. That's something that I think we really need to research more, get more idea of exactly you know, how much it can really help in that case. It increases the nutrient and water holding capacity of the mixes. It's a compost. Composts are usually relatively fine products that hold nutrients and water a little bit more. And some growers claim reduced incidence of some diseases when earthworm castings are added to the mix. Those are similar claims that I've seen with people saying that adding compost to a mix or homeowners adding compost to their garden see reduced disease. So those are the things that we see. Definitely I've seen in the past working with different growers where adding earthworm castings reduced the amount of fertilizer that they had to add to grow a crop and also can allow us to even slightly reduce the starter charge if need be. So just in finishing up on, in talking about worm castings, just a couple of pictures to show. This is at a production facility. We used our Sunshine number one natural and organic. And you can see that in this picture, the Sunshine number one NNO with vermicompost is the plant to the left and a little bit lower. The standard Sunshine number one NNO, which has been our standard product for years. The plants look good until you compare them to the plants with vermicompost. These plants were treated exactly the same, sowed on the same day. Everything was exactly the same other than the mix. So this showed a really big improvement by using vermicompost. And this was at 5% of the mix. And a trial we've done recently, again, comparing our standard number one NNO to number one NNO with earthworm castings, and also the bark mix with earthworm castings. So all of these mixes, the only difference between the number one NNO and the number one NNO with earthworm castings is that we put in 5% earthworm castings. And as you can see, the plants do look bigger with the earthworm castings added. And then just above that, I also put in what the average fresh and dry weights were for those plants. These are representative plants. We had 10 plants for each treatment. So these numbers are pretty accurate and they're really what we expected to see. So, that said, earthworm castings are really important for organic production just because of the issues we run into in trying to feed a crop during production with earthworm castings or without earthworm castings.
All right, great. Thank you very much, Dan. So you mentioned about the need for research work and specifically Cornell. I know that Cornell has got a great website with lots of really good information, and I've sent many growers there, and they've certainly done some rigorous research work showing disease suppression with composts. Are there any other sources of information that you'd suggest for growers?
One that comes to mind would be Worm Power. They've worked a lot with Cornell because their location is not too far from Cornell University. So they've done a lot of research on both vermicompost and extracts from vermicompost as well, and shown benefits in both cases. But definitely looking at websites for compost producers.
And I think you alluded to some of the potential benefits and pitfalls that are actually both related when it comes to disease management. So on the one hand, the potential to add beneficial microbes from vermicompost as well as a nutrient charge is a plus. But if you added too much of any compost material and you ended up getting a very fine mix that's heavy, that holds a lot of water and not enough air, that would work against you, and possibly too much nutrients as well.
Right. I totally agree with that. That's one of the reasons we've gone with the 5 to 10%.
Yep.
That's a little more forgiving. I know at 20%, you're going to get a bigger impact of the vermicompost. But in some cases, you may have some crops that at that point, they're a little too sensitive to that level of nutrients that might be available initially.
So on the nutrient side, I know with compost, one of the challenges is you've got a whole nitrogen cycle going on inside your container. And with organic mixes, sometimes you run into this issue of mineralization of the organic nitrogen turning into ammonium. And so that's a basic process. The pH goes up and then plant takes up the ammonium, or you get nitrification, pH goes down. So you get these pH swings, and you also can sometimes get a lot of ammonium. Do you find that the vermicompost is helping in any way there to give you a bit more stability?
What we've seen is that you definitely have a little bit higher ammonium initially, and that's more due to the starter charge. We've done tests where we don't put the starter charge in and the ammonium levels are okay. You actually start having a pretty good amount of nitrate almost immediately with the vermicompost from some of what we've seen. But yeah, I would say you can definitely see a lot of swings in pH. I've just dealt with a grower where their pH swing went from mid fives to upper fours and then to mid sixes. So it can go all over the place.
Yep.
And it's just dependent on the fertilizer, the extra organic fertilizer they use. And, the vermicompost is beneficial, but I think it acts as somewhat of a buffer. But at 5 to 10% in the mix, if you start having extremes of ammonium or other organic fertilizers, you will have to deal with pH swings, definitely.
And do you think that it's better to incorporate that vermicompost, sometime before you actually start using the mix, or is it better to just add it at the time that you're planting? What's the best approach there?
Well, I think you can definitely do it both ways. What I like about having it blended in before the mix is used, say from a soil blender, you have time that biological activity can kick in and help break down that starter charge. A lot of times growers will depend on that starter charge, especially if they're just starting to switch from standard production to organic production. The starter charge on a fresh mix is just not going to be that readily available. You're going to have a little bit available. But if you have certain types of crops that are nutrient intensive, you're going to have to get some more fertilizer on there in some way, shape, or form. So I think with the vermicompost, you're adding fertilizer, usually a pretty good amount that's readily available. And like I said, I really think it does increase the biological activity to help break down that other fertilizer that you're adding.
Right. So you move along that nitrogen cycle path. So getting closer
to
more of a nitrate type source, which would certainly be.
Yeah.
And one of those photos that you showed, Dan, there with the basil test that you were doing, it looked like those were basil plants in an NFT system. And Was that semi-hydroponic, or was that just kind of gutter type production?
It was just gutter production. So it's, you know, they're basically just running water through there, and sometimes some type of organic fertilizer through there as well.
Are sodium or chloride levels ever an issue for these vermicomposts or other organic fertilizers, or are those levels pretty low?
Well, definitely in sodium nitrate, you're definitely going to have sodium level issues. The vermicompost, the sources that we've run across so far that we've tested and that we've accepted for use in our facilities all have very good, you know, acceptable levels. You're always going to get a little bit of sodium and chloride, nothing of major issue. But I can see where, depending, again, it's all going to depend on the feedstock that the worms have as to whether or not you're going to have that issue. But generally, I don't see that. And some of the biggest suppliers are using mostly peat moss as their feedstock or bedding for the worms. And so we're not running into a lot of sodium issues there either.
Okay, great. Well, that's excellent information. I really appreciate you sharing that with us today. Any final thoughts of tips for growers in terms of using vermicompost?
I think the same tips as I would have for any mix: test, keep testing, and keep track of what's going on, and just be vigilant at making sure you're not getting wide swings, and if you are, what may be causing them, and correct the issues as quickly as you can.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Dan.
All right. Thank you.